Good evening, everyone. For those of you I don't know, I'm Ruth Mandel, director here at Eagleton, and this is one of the, well, whenever I get up to introduce someone, I say, it's such a pleasure. And it is, really. It's one of the pleasures of this job that I get to introduce lots of wonderful, interesting programs here at the Institute. And that's to say, we never make a mistake. We never schedule a bad program. But it is, it's on an occasion like this that we have a special, those of us who are directors of institutes and heads of programs at the university, we have special pleasure, any of us, when we head an academic unit. Namely, it's the opportunity to feature one of our outstanding colleagues, and in this case, an outstanding colleague who is, I use this word carefully, breathtakingly productive. It's hard to keep up with him. He has a hard time keeping up with himself. He often comes into my office and saying, oh, I can't do it all. David Redlawsk, who is professor of political science, as I know you all know, and director of the Eagleton Center for Public Interest Polling here at the Institute, he really is hard to keep up with, literally. Among his many activities, and I'm not even going to begin to list all of them, but just to point out that you're probably aware that he is the director of the Eagleton poll. I'm mentioning that first because if you're on the Twitter account or if you're on the Eagleton poll account, you're getting, I don't want to use the word bombarded, Dave, but I'm sitting in meetings and I forgot to turn my phone off and I keep getting the tweets. Many, many releases from a very active Eagleton poll that is in recent days, most recently focused on the subject of the governor of this state. And we have, as a result of that intense focus, we have been, I was sitting having dinner last week, I think it was, and my husband said, oh, look, Ruth, there's the Eagleton poll. That was MSNBC. And it's getting a lot of attention because Dave has been building a body of data about our governor that the governor might not appreciate, but Dave will use for future research purposes. He is, in addition to that, one of the most active and successful classroom educators that we have here at Eagleton, and we've had some wonderful and continue to have some wonderful professors. This year, he's taken over. Jerry Pomper is in the room, and where is Jerry? There you are. A course that Jerry was renowned for. Jerry taught for, I was going to say years, but it was like decades, right? In the Eagleton Undergraduate Associates Program, and we wished him well last year as he went off to do other things, and Dave has taken over the course, and he has done something different with it, equally, I don't know, equally successful, not equally, but absolutely successful. And to walk into the building on a Wednesday morning this semester, he is he has chosen to run a simulation at a municipal level with the students in this class. And so the level of energy and giggling and running around in the building on this floor on Wednesday mornings tells me, at least, that there's a lot of learning and a lot of fun going on at the same time. And that's certainly typical of the courses he teaches. He's a very imaginative, creative professor. He's also, having said all of that, he's not around very often. He's constantly traveling. And if you try to get in touch with him by emails, you will pretty often get a message back saying, I am away now, and I will check email, and never believe it, by the way, that he's not going to check it often, because he does. But he says, I'm away, and I will be back on such and such date. And this is because he travels really an unbelievable pace of travel to meetings, professional meetings and conferences, to give papers and meet with colleagues in his role as co-editor of the journal Political Psychology. He is also the author or co-author of book after book, resulting from his research, which focuses on campaigns, elections, the role of information in voter decision making, and on emotional responses to campaign information. Dave has grants, prestigious grants from the National Science Foundation, and he currently serves as the on the board of the American National Election Studies, and some of his books have gotten awards, and I can't repeat it all, and you've got some of it in your programs, or else I would refer you to our website. Tonight, we're celebrating the publication of his latest book, and if you hold on tight, in about a month, the next book is coming out.
A couple of months.
Okay, sometime during the summer. But this is his latest book. It's called The Positive Case, as you know, for Negative Campaigning. This is a title I was thinking that's most suitable for the editor of a journal of political psychology. One last note. Despite whatever he explains tonight, Dave is not a negative guy. If you don't believe me, I would refer you, if you haven't had the good fortune yet, I would refer you to his Facebook page, where you'll find entry after entry.
We have a lot to protect in Hillsboro. Our open.
Unfortunately, we had it set.
Sorry.
I'm sorry, you'll fix it. I shouldn't have had it set to go. That would have solved it.
Where you'll find entry after entry, photo after photo of a very cheerful, laughing, happy Dave having the time of his life at work and play. And that's a great pleasure to see. So it is my pleasure to introduce my colleague, Dave Redlawsk, a happy, productive, successful professor.
And all.
That's what I get for friending my boss on Facebook, right? Okay, let's try to set this up again. Well, hello, thanks for coming. Thanks, Ruth, for that over-generous introduction. I really am not quite sure what to say, and I'm not quite sure that this talk's going to actually live up to that. If nothing else, it probably has far too many slides, so I'd better get into it. I should note my co-author, Kyle Maddies, who is responsible for one of the core parts of the book that I'm only going to skim because it's an area that I'm not as familiar with, which is why he's responsible for it. But I also should point out that, unfortunately, the University Press, Chicago University Press, is actually responsible for the title. We had something sort of dumber we called Negative About Negativity, and the marketing people at the press were, well, that's not going to sell, right? Negative about negativity, and that's not what you're saying anyway. We had a question mark after it. And so they sent me an email saying, how about the positive case for negative campaigning? And my reaction was, that's just brilliant. And it is. And so you have to give credit where it is due. I should note, came up quicker than I thought it would. I should note, I'm going to start off by showing you some ads and giving you some sense of a couple of different things about why negativity itself in particular is not theoretical for me. I don't engage in politics as the director of the Rutgers Eagleton poll. My job is to try to understand public opinion and report as accurately as possible about public opinion, but I do have, and Ruth hates it when I mention it, but I do have a past. It's not a particularly secret because of the existence of the internet. You can just Google my name, and it's an unusual enough name that's easy. But I actually have been involved in politics. I've considered myself a recovering politician for a number of years now, in two different communities, in two different states, and for both political parties. I have served in elective office both as a Republican and as a Democrat. If that's not the perfect balance sample, I don't know what is. So I want to start here. Now I have to get this to come up now. I want to start with some ads.
We have a lot to protect in Hillsboro. Our open space, our small town values, a corner of New Jersey unlike any other. Four Democrats for Township Committee are determined to preserve Hillsboro just the way it is. Christine Jensen, John Gilardi, Sonia Ann Martin, and Bob Mack. They're fighting the Greenbrier development and its 3,000 new houses, and they'll preserve our open space without raising taxes. The Hillsborough Democrats, to preserve Hillsborough.
That's essentially a positive ad. They talked about what they're doing, who they are, what they're going to do. It was all nice, warm, fuzzy, friendly. Here's another one.
I'm Congressman Bob Franks, and I'd like to tell you about Chickie Haynes. Chickie has always put Hillsborough first. As deputy mayor, she wrote the law creating Hillsborough's open space program, the first of its kind in Somerset County. And she's helped preserve nearly 1,000 acres of valuable open space. Now, Chickie has a plan to stop overdevelopment by protecting 2,000 acres by the year 2000. I know Chickie Haynes. I trust her to do what's right for Hillsborough, and I know you can too.
So both of these are basically positive ads. They seem pretty much like a throwback. These are from, what, 16, 17 years ago, maybe a bit of an endangered species these days, a bit of an anomaly. But to some degree, you know, they're nice. They feel warm and fuzzy. They're not, we would argue, all that particularly informative. These two have a little bit of information in them, but most positive ads are kind of puffery. I'm so great, aren't I wonderful? Here's the flag, here's the pretty music. Let's turn instead to kind of the other side.
There's a Republican time bomb just waiting to explode in Hillsborough. Uncontrolled growth eating away at open space. Failure to enforce building safety laws. Overcrowded schools forcing higher taxes. Ever-growing congestion on Route 206 and no end in sight. Let Dave Redlawsk and Steve Sloan defuse the Republican time bomb before time runs out. On November 2nd, elect Democrats Redlawsk and Sloan to Township Committee, paid for by Redlawsk Sloan 93, Dangelotti, Treasurer.
That was, as far as I know, the first time a TV ad ran in a Hillsborough Township Committee race. We went over to the cable TV operation in Hillsborough back when those things were local. We spent a few hundred dollars to create the ad in the studio and a few hundred more dollars to run it. And it was amazing how cheap it was to run local advertising like that. But it was the only ad we ran, and you'll notice it's not exactly a positive ad. It takes on a pretty much they're bad. At the very end, it kind of says, we'll do something about it. But we were the challengers. We weren't the incumbents. And one of the things we had to do was figure out how to get people to stop voting for the incumbents. I should point out, however, that we lost.
David Redlawsk is lying to you about Chickie Haynes. Here's why. Redlawsk took $52,000 from a developer who is suing Hillsborough to build 2,400 new apartments on Route 206. It's a fact. The Democrats' apartments will cost you higher property taxes and will lower the value of your home. Keep the Democrats' apartments out of Hillsborough. Vote no on Redlawsk.
I wanted to meet that announcer. I thought that voice was just fantastic. I didn't feel so good about the ad. This came actually in my reelection campaign. I didn't win in 93, but I won in 95. In an effort, obviously, to unseat me, it was a. It came in the last week or two, and it was a gut punch. I mean, it really was. I had people who were on my side say, "Did you really take $52,000?" And I said, no, it says it's a fact, which almost certainly means it is not. The point, however, is that in some sense, no matter what we think about the advertising or the process, I wanted to start off by letting you know that this isn't just theoretical for me. I've had the experience of this, both perpetrating it, but as well as being the target as well. Essentially, no matter what, if you're a political candidate, you just need to understand it is rough out there. It is going to be rough out there, no matter what you do. It's going to be rough out there. And to be honest, that's, in our opinion, how it ought to be. That this kind of negativity, whether you like it or not, whether it's goes a little beyond the pale, perhaps. I'd like to think I'm not a hypocrite. It provides information into an environment that otherwise would not be there. At least some of that information is, in fact, true and accurate, hopefully not this one, and actually adds something that wouldn't be there without the negativity. But lest you think this is something really new to politics, I'm going to look at this quote. Finally, as regards the masses, be sure to put on a good show. It also wouldn't hurt to remind them of what scoundrels your opponents are and to smear these men at every opportunity with the crimes, sexual scandals, and corruption they have brought on themselves. Cicero, actually Cicero's brother, to him in a letter advising him on his campaign for consul in 64 BCE, right? Cicero's brother says, go negative. The election of 1800, the opponents of John Adams called him a hideous hermaphroditical character, which has neither the force and firmness of a man nor the gentleness and sensibility of a woman. Well, it wasn't like the Adams fans just sat back. They said if Thomas Jefferson wins, murder, robbery, rape, adultery, and incest will all be openly taught and practiced. The air will be rent with the cries of the distressed. The soil will be soaked with blood and the nation black with crimes. So this isn't really something new. Right? When Andrew Jackson was running for president in 1824, some of his opponents published this. You can't read any details, but it reads at the top, some account of some of the bloody deeds of General Jackson. And these are obviously coffins along the way. And Lincoln, Honest Abe, subject to negative campaigning. Elect Lincoln and the black Republican ticket, you'll bring on Negro equality, more debt, harder times, another draft, universal anarchy, and ultimate ruin. But elect McClellan and the Democratic ticket, you will defeat Negro equality, restore prosperity, reestablish the Union in honorable, permanent, and happy peace. Right? This, by the way, is not a negative ad. Political scientists call it a contrast ad, because it says something bad, but it also says something good about the sponsor of the ad. The point I want to make generally, of course, is firstly, this stuff isn't new. When you have election contests in which essentially it's a zero-sum game, if you do not win, you lose. And under the assumption that you believe in yourself, you're running because you really do think you will make a difference, your loss would be a terrible thing for the community. It'd be a horrible thing. And so, don't the ends justify the means? But let's start a little bit back from this and think about what do we mean by negativity. I like to think it's a little bit like what Justice Potter Stewart said on pornography. I know it when I see it, right? It's a fairly difficult thing to define in very specific terms, which is something researchers need to do. We can talk about it in general terms. We can talk about what kinds of ads are negative. We can talk about the tone and the form and what have you. But we need to have a working definition from a research standpoint. And what we chose to do is what many others have done in political science, and in particular following on, as we do in a lot of this work, on a book by John Gear from 2006 called In Defense of Negativity. Our working definition is going to be any ad that talks about an opponent is a negative ad. And if you think there's a logic to that, right? I mean, who in their right mind would say something positive about their opponent? It makes sense to think that if the opponent's mentioned, it almost certainly has to be in a negative way. So what's been happening with negativity? Well, one thing that Gear has documented and has been updated with the 2012 election is this sense that negativity seems to be always getting worse, right? That in some sense, it just gets worse and worse. This is presidential election campaigns. This is a indication of the share of negativity in presidential campaigns. Going back to 1960, when you can see it was below about 10% of all the ads, although it was not non-existent. There's a great anti-Nixon ad by the Kennedy forces in which they have Eisenhower being asked at a press conference, can you tell us anything that Richard Nixon has actually done as vice president? And Eisenhower's response is to kind of stand there and say, well, if you give me a minute, I'll try to think of something. And so A week, I'm sorry, thank you, you're right. Give me a week, I'll think of something. And it was used, obviously, as an attack ad on Nixon by the Kennedy forces. Well, here are some of the quotes we've seen over the last 20 years. In 1988, the election was, by all indications, the nastiest presidential race in memory. By 1992, George W. Bush, who was, of course, a candidate, called it the worst political year I've ever seen, the ugliest, the nastiest, everything goes, no accountability. In 1996, Bernard Shaw, CNN, said it's the nastiest bare-knuckled, direct-to-the-gut campaign. In 2000, that was one of the scruffiest, nastiest, silliest, most devoid of responsible content in recent memory campaigns. 2004, the LA Times opined that attacks by both parties have taken incivility to a new level this year. And Daryl West in 2008 said, it's reached all-time lows in the use of misleading and inaccurate political appeals. But of course, he was apparently not right, because by 2012, the estimate is that about 80% of all advertising in the presidential campaign was negative advertising. And again, let me remind you, the definition of, in this case, is a fairly simple definition, which is the fact that the advertising in some form or another mentioned the candidate on the other side. There are some distinctions. I mentioned the idea, for example, of contrast ads, where we not only talk about the other side in negative terms, but we say something nice about our side. And there's also an important distinction that we get at in the book to some degree in a little bit different of an angle, which is between what we might call legitimate attacks and mudslinging. And so one of our questions really is if we can differentiate legitimate attacks from what we call defamatory attacks, can we see the public responding differently to these? And I'll come to that in a moment. Now, it's always getting worse. Surveys tell us that voters don't like it. In 87%, in one survey said they were concerned about personal attacks. In another survey, 61% were very much bothered by negative campaigning. 60% said negative ads make people feel less like voting on election day. In fact, there's such a consensus generally that the public hates negative campaigning that pollsters don't even ask about it anymore. We actually can't find much newer than about 2004 in terms of polling asking whether people like or dislike negative campaigning. So to take all of this together, we would suggest that what voters really want is something like this from Ulysses S. Grant and Henry Wilson. Ulysses S. Grant, the Galena Tanner, and Henry Wilson, the Natick Shoemaker. And this is devoid of any real content, but it's to make you feel good about these guys. They're average people, you know, they're wearing the aprons of their job that they supposedly are part of. You know, we can go, wow, these are great guys, I want to vote for them. Apparently this really is, to hear commentators and even political scientists talk about negativity, the kind of thing we'd rather have, right? Just something about how great everybody is. So I'm actually curious in the room, how many of you think it's okay for a candidate to tell voters about the good things he or she has done? Oh, good. I assume that would be the case. It should be pretty close to unanimous. How many of you think it's okay for a candidate to contrast herself with the opponent talking about the opponent's record? Still most of, right? Most everybody put their hand up. But how many of you think that negativity is bad, that campaigns should focus on the positive? Be honest. I mean, yeah, it's okay. It's okay. It's a pretty large number of people. Well, pretty much, if you said yes to my second question, it's okay to contrast with the other candidate and talk about the other candidate's record, but you didn't, but you also said you think negativity is bad, you're essentially contradicting yourself. How else are you going to talk about an opponent and an opponent's record? How are you going to contrast yourself without inherently being negative, right? I'm not going to say, My opponent's record is just absolutely wonderful on this issue. It's something we should all agree to do because it's the best possible way to do it, right? No, you're not going to say that. You're going to say, my opponent is wrong. My opponent is terrible. My opponent's done a bad job. Here's what I will do, right? So my point is that it's not necessarily the actual act of negativity, but perhaps it's the way it is done, right, that bothers people. We probably, presumably, do want to know the good and the bad of all the choices in front of us, right? I mean, if you think about this sort of logically, just knowing the good about all the choices in front of you is not complete information, right? We need to know the pros and the cons. In some sense, if we don't know the cons, we can't make that list, pro, con, what's good, what's bad. And so it seems to be important to understand how candidates compare to each other, right? And so ultimately, we have to think about this as a choice. Decision-making in an election is a choice, and choice is inherently about comparisons. So if candidates cannot go negative, how are we going to get to that point? How are we going to know the difference of good and bad, and how are we going to make an informed choice? So that's what we're at here. That's kind of our starting point for all of this. And so our argument is relatively simple, the core argument in the book. One is that negative information about an opponent is important to having a complete information environment. Okay? Without that, the environment is incomplete. Voters do not have everything they need to know. No candidate is going to tell you bad things about themselves, at least not on purpose. They may do it by accident. They may get taped hearing something, saying something about 47% or other things like that, but they're not going to purposefully introduce into the information environment the negatives about themselves. Somebody actually has to do that. But on the other hand, it's going to be pretty difficult to present a positive message about your faults if you're a candidate, in which case, presumably, you should just stay quiet. So you should just campaign on the positive things, stay quiet about your negative things, and hope, and of course, if we had the environment that many would like, you'd be sure that no one can bring it up in the negative sense because negative campaigning would not be allowed. Now, the thing is, you're a smart voter. Everybody in this room is a smart voter. I'm pretty sure, maybe, that you can infer that there are problems in the areas that the candidate ignores. So if a candidate chooses not to talk about something, there's a logical inference to be made there, which is the candidate has nothing good to say about it. So in sort of a simplified environment, if a candidate doesn't talk, you should infer that there's something wrong. It turns out, however, much like the dog that doesn't bark in the Sherlock Holmes story, this is really hard to do. In that classic story, there's a kidnapping of a prize racehorse. The iconic detective Sherlock Holmes is summoned to investigate the crime. He famously solves the case by focusing on a critical piece of evidence, a guard dog that doesn't bark during the commission of the crime, right? The dog that did not bark. The problem is most of us actually aren't very good at that, or it wouldn't be an interesting Sherlock Holmes story, right? If you ever read the story, the first time you read the story, you had no idea what was going on. It was really hard to figure it out. And then he points out the dog that didn't bark. Therefore, the midnight visitor was someone the dog must have known well. Voters have to be able to do the same thing if candidates stay silent and if their opponents are not allowed to point it out. That is, the lack of information can be meaningful, but pretty hard for us to make sense of such a lack. And so negativity comes into play where the other side can point out, why didn't she talk about X? Well, I'll tell you, she's really bad on X. But there is a puzzle we do have to address, and this is where we start with our empirical work. And the puzzle is in some sense kind of simple, right? Candidates want to win. It's kind of funny. I even think that those candidates who we all know have a snowball's chance of winning want to win, and maybe even think they can win. I don't know of a campaign that has seriously gone on without at least some thinking, yeah, I can win this, I want to win this. Well, if voters dislike negativity so much, which is the claim, which is what all that polling stuff showed, right, shouldn't voters punish the perpetrators of negativity, remembering that campaigns want to win? And so if the perpetrators are punished, shouldn't campaigns recognize it and adjust accordingly, right? There's a logical problem here. If negativity is bad, if voters want to punish you for being negative, if it's a terrible thing to do, and you want to win, you shouldn't do terrible things. Our take on this is that maybe voters are not quite as negative about negativity as we think they are, as the conventional wisdom thinks they are, and that hence was our original title, right? Negative about negativity, question mark. So let's take a look at that. Do voters really hate negativity? As we said, they do hate it when we ask them in surveys, right? It is extraordinarily rare to have people stand up and say, you bet, love that stuff. It's the greatest thing ever. Instead, when we ask them, we ask, you know, do you approve personal attacks? Do you approve negative campaigning? And if you think about that, who would want to approve such a thing? I don't care what it is. If you ask the question about negativity, do you approve negativity? People are going to say, no, I don't approve negativity. I don't think negativity is a good thing at all. There's this idea of a social desirability bias in survey research in particular, where respondents tell you what they think you want to hear, right, for a whole host of possible reasons. And we started off thinking maybe something like that's going on here. If we ask people if they don't like negativity, we do it in a survey, the respondent answering the interviewer says, well, no, I don't like negativity. Of course not. Who would like negativity? And so we're wondering, and we were wondering in this, whether the starting point, the negative about negativity point, was really an artifact of the way the questions got asked. So we did some simple question wording experiments in several different surveys, including one we did here at Eagleton in 2009 in the run-up to the gubernatorial election, and several others, national surveys as well. In the presidential election, we focused on whether people hate the phrase or the action. That is, do they hate negativity or do they hate the act of going negative? That is, talking about an opponent. In the New Jersey gubernatorial, we focused on topics, because it's one thing to talk generally about negativity, but there are a lot of different nuances involved, and topics may make a big difference. That is, it's one thing perhaps to attack your opponent on the issues. It may be another thing entirely to attack your opponent on, oh, let's say religion, all right? So we wanted to look at issues of topics. And in the third study, which focused on the 2010 congressional election, we looked again at topics, but we expanded the list, and we asked also about the believability of negative advertising and tried to look at how that might play a role. So looking at these, in the first study, the presidential election, we asked a question. Our focus was on the emotional response of anger. That is, people talk about being angry about negativity. So we decided to focus on anger as the emotional response. And the question asked in the survey, how would you feel if a political candidate began to use negative campaigning? That is, began to run ads to give you information about what his opponent had done in office. The words in red were dropped for half the sample and included for half the sample. So half the sample doesn't have the word negative campaigning in it. It simply says, how would you feel if a political candidate began to run ads to give you information about what his opponent had done in office? The other version has negative campaigning in it. We also asked about truth. We were sort of curious, well, what if people think the ads are true? So what if these ads, while negative, again, half got while negative, half did not, told the truth about an opponent? Would these be much more acceptable, somewhat more acceptable, no more acceptable than other negative ads about an opponent? So that's the setup for the first study. It's a very, very simple question wording experiment. And by the fact that we actually published a book, you can guess which way it went. When we included negative campaigning, there were substantially greater anger responses, right? Nearly a quarter said they were very angry when the words negative campaigning are included, and more than 40% somewhat angry. So we're talking about two-thirds being at least somewhat angry. But in the question version that does not include the phrase negative campaigning, but is otherwise exactly the same, very, very different response, just about 10% very angry, under a quarter somewhat angry. So fewer than half are at the same level of anger when we don't include negative campaigning. I'm used to talking a lot. You'd think my voice would hold up. When we talked about truth, what we found was that truth can mitigate effects even for ads seen as negative. So when we cued people with the negative campaigning piece, but we said, what if they were true? 30% said that would be much more acceptable. And another almost 40% said that would be somewhat more acceptable. So there's a little bit of a hint here that there is a differentiation. Right? If we perceive the negativity as being false, like Redlawsk took $52,000, I hope people perceived as false, they are, you know, not so thrilled about it. But if they see truth in it, acceptability goes up. We get a similar dynamic when we don't cue it as negativity, right? When we just say talking about an opponent, it's a little bit stronger, but it's basically the same response. So in some sense, truth can mitigate the effects of negative ads. Very simple experiment, very simple test to try to get at this question of, do the words matter? And our takeaway is, the words matter. So with that starting point, we're asking then about the topics. Well, not every negative campaign is equal. Not every negative ad is equal. Sometimes they go beyond the pale. Sometimes they seem much more acceptable. And so we started with that simple working definition, talking about an opponent. But that's surely not the whole story. So our thought was, okay, we're still doing survey experiments. We're still asking people questions. We're not showing them ads here. We're just asking them questions. But let's let some of our respondents tell us what is negative. Right? Not let us tell them what is negative. And so we came up with four topics that seemed to appear in lots of negative ads. The fourth one not as often, but we found some examples. So attacking the opponent on a lack of experience, talking about the opponent's prior record in office, talking about the opponent's position on issues, again, presumably not in a positive way, and talking about the opponent's family. Right? And so our question manipulates the use of negative again. Asks people in some of our sample, I'm not going into the details of how we did this, but in some of our sample, we asked people to tell us, if you think a candidate running such an ad would be running a negative campaign, and we gave them each of those topics. For those people, once they told us whether they thought it would be negative or not, we then asked how much it would anger them. And so this is a self-definition of negativity. For others, we didn't let them self-define, we called it a negative ad, and we said, what if a candidate used a negative ad to talk about an opponent's, and again, that same list of topics. So the point here, for those who are not particularly familiar with this kind of experimental work, is that by randomly assigning respondents to different versions of the question, we can wash out differences across those respondents. So for example, we might find that Democrats respond to the questions differently from Republicans. And so unless we can wash out those differences, how do we know that it isn't just because the mix of Democrats and Republicans? By randomly putting people into one of these versions, we assure statistically that there's basically no difference between the groups, and any change we see is exactly because of the change in the way we ask the questions. So the first point was, what's negative? And so this is to the people who were asked to self-define as negative, so just part of the sample. What we found, of course, not at all surprising, right, is more than 90% offered that talking about an opponent's family is inherently negative. And that makes some sense. For most of us, we would think that that's not particularly relevant to the campaign environment, right? On the other hand, things that are relevant, the lack of experience, the record in office, position on issues. In all of these cases, far less than a majority said that would be negative if a candidate did that. Right? So we get some sense now that there are differences in topics. Some things are more acceptable than others. This is the second version of the question. So we had the negative campaigning in, and we had self-defined people. That is, the group that got to tell us if it was negative. So the blue lines here represent the people who got to tell us no matter whether they said it was negative or positive. And the other lines represent the question with negative campaigning. And once again, we see the same basic finding we found in the first study. Using the word negative increases negativity, in this case increases anger, and it does it significantly and substantively in all cases. There's not a lot of room to increase on family because it was already at 90-something percent. Among the people who self-defined as negative, that is, said, yes, this topic is negative, and the way the chart works here, the percentage in brackets is the percentage who said that topic was negative when asked to self-define. Self-defining as negative drastically increases the emotional response, the negative emotional response. So those of the 34% who said talking about opponents' experiences negative, nearly 60% said they would be angered by it, right? Of the 92% who said talking about family, nearly all of them said they'd be angered about it. The blue line represents the people who denied that that was negative. And so in the case of experience, that would be the other 66%, the other two-thirds of the sample, and they're not bothered at all, really. And pretty much the same with the record and issues. 81% said it's not negative to talk about your opponent on the issues, and 20% of the people who said that were angered, but the other 80% were not. Again, what we're trying to get at here are differences in how we ask a question has significant effects on how people respond, which suggests that that sense of negative about negativity, everyone hates negativity, really just is not true. It's an artifact of the way we ask the question. So we looked a little further, looking at five topics gleaned from a set of actual ads. The experience and the issues were repeated from the previous study. These are about qualifications and about policy. We added one about an opponent being convicted of fraud. Is that okay to talk about? It's a character assessment considered to generally be something we should know about candidates, their character. And there was an actual ad that had this, which is why we picked up that an opponent was convicted of fraud. We repeated the family question, which we don't see as directly relevant to deciding about a vote. And we added atheism, religion, as a not directly relevant thing. So we focused here on three basic questions. How angry? Would it make you more likely to vote for the candidate running the ad or the opponent? The idea of backlash. And how believable would it be? The same idea with the other experiments. The word negative is either there or it is not. Once again, we essentially repeat the findings, which is why they're here. Issues. Fewer than about 15% said it's negative to do that, and about 15% said it made us angry. Lack of experience. Fraud is because, you know, we didn't give them the actual ad. They can't really assess the legitimacy of the ad. But even not knowing that, about half of them said it would be not necessarily negative. And they weren't, you know, and more than half were not particularly angered by it. Atheism, family, bad stuff to go negative on if you're a candidate. Backlash. There's a lot of talk about whether voters have this backlash. You go negative, you're going to lose votes. They're going to say, you're a horrible person, I'm going to vote for the other side. And at least in this study where we ask vote intention, it's not an actual vote, it really depends on the topic. Some topics generate a great deal of backlash, and that's particularly that family topic or the atheism topic. But, you know, go negative on issues, go negative on experience, even go negative on fraud if there's something there. And it doesn't seem to make people go, wow, I should not vote for you. I should vote for the opponent because you're just a terrible person. And finally, on this set of stuff, believability. Essentially, we asked, is it very believable, somewhat believable, not very believable, if a candidate were to use these kinds of topics? And same story, right? People aren't going to believe you if you attack on family. They're not going to believe you if you attack on religion. They're much more likely to believe you if you attack on things that are relevant to the campaign. Okay. So the takeaways from this part of the study, voters do complain about negativity. We can't disagree with that. It's true, right? Voters complain, even if you don't do a survey, we know people complain about negativity. We love in a campaign to all tell each other, did you see how bad that ad was? Oh man, isn't it terrible? It's nothing but negativity. You should live in Iowa ahead of a caucus. Every single possible advertising minute on TV is taken up with political ads, virtually all of which are negative. Right, but there is no, like the local car dealer ad, they can't get their ads in because it's all been bought out by campaigns. And we'd love to talk about it. But it's mostly, we think, because we tell them to think negatively when we ask a question about it, right? The idea that negativity is simply talking about an opponent is lacking. The topics matter. Less negative. All of those topics were less seen as less negative when people were allowed to self-define it versus being told. And some information, nonetheless, is not just valid, some of the negative information, but it's also believable. Right? It's perfectly reasonable, but there are topics beyond the pale. Speaking of which, I want to show you some ads from the 2008 North Carolina Senate campaign. It'll take a second, I think, for this to roll up here. That campaign got to be pretty nasty. The incumbent was Elizabeth Dole. The challenger was Kay Hagan. Ultimately, Hagan won that election.
I'm Kay Hagan, and Elizabeth Dole's attacks on my Christian faith are offensive. She even faked my voice in her TV ad to make you think I don't believe in God. Well, I believe in God. I taught Sunday school. My faith guides my life, and Senator Dole knows it. Sure, politics is a tough business, but I approve this message because my campaign is about creating jobs and fixing our economy, not bearing false witness against fellow Christians.
So I showed you this one first. It's actually a reply, obviously. There's something else going on. But one of the things we did in one of our studies was we randomly assigned people to view this ad and the Elizabeth Dole ad in different order. So half the sample viewed the Elizabeth Dole ad first, which is how it came in real life. Half viewed this ad first. Keep that in mind. Let me show you the Elizabeth Dole ad here.
I'm Elizabeth Dole, and I approved this message.
A leader of the Godless Americans PAC recently held a secret fundraiser in Kay Hagan's honor.
There is no God to rely on. There was no Jesus.
Well, Hagan, under God, I the Pledge of Allegiance, you're down with that.
We're down with that.
And in God we trust, you're going to whip that off the money?
Yeah, we would.
Godless Americans and Kay Hagan. She hid from cameras, took godless money. What did Hagan promise in return?
There is no God.
So this came very late in the campaign. Dole was down in the polls. It looked like she was going to lose. She did lose, and some people think this was why, but she may well have been losing in any case. The reason I showed them to you in that order was just to give it a little bit of context. Our sense is not only do voters understand that different topics have different levels of negativity, that they're not bothered by some, but they're very bothered by others, and here's an example of a religion, the atheism question, but that they also can make sense of the context of things. And so the way to read this chart, the first two rows are the Dole ad first. So when people viewed the Dole ad first, 99% of them said it was negative. Then they viewed the Hagan ad, and 27% said that one was negative. But the people who viewed the Hagan ad first without the context of Dole, 56% said the Hagan ad was negative. Now, virtually everybody still said the Dole ad was negative. It was very negative. They were angered by it. It was not believable. It was not appropriate. The Hagan ad, however, varies dramatically depending on the context in which it is viewed. If it is viewed out of context, oh no, this is terrible. It's a negative ad. Why is she doing that? But if it's viewed in context, it's seen as a legitimate response to the situation in the campaign. So I just wanted to show you that to give you a sense that we don't only think people understand the differences, but we think the context matters and they're clear about how context matters. We also showed a group of people 21 actual ads, 9 of which were positive, 12 of which were negative. Of those negative ads, 5 of them were what we call defamatory, including the Dole ad. and several others. There were some other pretty nasty things out there. And we asked people how negative they are. This plots without worrying about which ad. The first thing is people recognize positive ads, right? All the blue ones, they're positive. They're not negative. Nobody said they were negative, or virtually nobody. The red squares are the negative ads we had, and the defamatory ads are the green triangles. These folks who hadn't necessarily seen these before, we just showed them all these ads. We did this in an online study, and we had hundreds of people in the study, sorted them exactly the way we would have sorted them based on the context of the ad, based on what was in the ad. And they responded to them pretty much exactly the way we thought they would. That is, people differentiate, and they're smart enough to differentiate. That's one of the messages of the book, is that people are smart enough to differentiate. They can make sense of this negativity, and the negativity is valuable. So I want to pull that together on this question of the necessity of negativity, the kind of final argument we make in the book. In one of the studies, we asked people how helpful would certain kinds of ads be. And we said, what if you did? Somebody ran an ad on an opponent's record? How helpful would that be? What if they ran an ad about issue differences? What if they ran an ad about their own broad governing plans? What if they ran an ad complaining the opponent was negative? What if they ran an ad about the opponent's faith? Well, as you can see, of course, people don't think those faith-based ads are particularly helpful, and they shouldn't. They don't think complaining is particularly helpful, and they shouldn't. But the takeaway on this chart is that these two other areas of negativity, the opponent's record and issue difference contrasting, are actually seen as more helpful than the positive ad of, here's what I'm going to do. So again, real voters say to pollsters, I hate negativity. To us, they say, yeah, but you know, it's kind of helpful. So our theoretical position is this. In a world where negative campaigns, however defined, are banned, candidates can only present positive campaign or not campaign at all, and the information environment will be incomplete. Voters, however, cannot deduce the same information from a candidate's failure to campaign positively that they get from information-filled attacks by the other side. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if the information is not provided in the environment, voters are not very good at inferring its existence. Let me follow up on that. What we had to do, however, to test this was something in a laboratory. We can't test it in the real world. There's no counterfactual. What would have happened if? The campaign happens, candidates go negative or not, there's a vote, there's a result. We can't go back and say, well, what if something else had happened? So our question for testing is, can a voter learn what a candidate doesn't say? This is that dog that doesn't bark. And we do this through a laboratory game. Not going to get into any of the details about this, except that we had three players in each round of the game, one assigned randomly to be a voter and two assigned randomly to be candidates. Candidates were assigned to be good or bad on two dimensions, just called X and Y. So they're randomly, according to a certain algorithm, have a good position on X or a bad position on X, a good position on Y or a bad position on Y. The candidates in the campaign reveal their position on one of the attributes. They can reveal that they're positive on X or they're positive on Y. They can reveal that the opponent is negative on X or negative on Y. They can choose to not campaign, and they were constrained to tell the truth only. So the way I'm trying to set this up is think about two people as candidates who are told they've got good or bad positions. They also know what the other candidate has, good or bad positions, but the voter does not know. Candidates only reveal one piece of information, right? And they have to decide what to reveal. That's the campaign. The voter then sees one piece from candidate A, one piece from candidate B, and has to make a choice, right? So, big deal. Well, the big deal is this. They made money. That is, the people who participated in this study made money based on the decisions they made. When they chose a candidate who was positive on both X and Y, they got 100 points. They chose a candidate who was only positive on X but not Y, they got 80 points. Negative on X but positive on Y, they got 20 points. If they chose a candidate who was bad on both things, they got no points. Now remember, they don't know all of this information. They only know the one piece revealed by each candidate. For the candidate, the incentive is real simple. You win, you get 100 points. You lose, you get zero. Now, every subject in this went through 80 rounds, and they were randomly paired in groups of three each round, so it wasn't the same people every time in the lab. Here's the problem. Naive voters cannot figure out what the absence of a message means. In this study, if you fail to positively campaign on X, that means that candidate is bad on X, because X has the highest payoff. If you as a candidate are good on X, that's what you're going to reveal. You'd better reveal it, because the voter needs to know it. If you don't reveal it, it reveals two pieces of information: the thing you did and the fact that you are not good on X. The problem is, naive voters, and as it turns out, that's most voters, do not understand this. They cannot make sense of that. Sophisticated voters can. Since it's always better to campaign on a positive X because the voter makes more, the candidate will always do it if it's at all possible. And so if the candidate doesn't, they must be bad on X. And sophisticated voters will understand that. So with naive voters, even when they know a candidate might be bad on X, they don't realize it solely based on the candidate's failure to campaign on X. That means the opponent has to point it out. And ironically, it leads to more negativity if candidates believe voters are naive, because otherwise, voters won't have the information that they need. There's this thing called a positivity offset. In the absence of any information at all, zero information, we tend to believe there are positive qualities in other people. Opponents then must go negative to make the point clear in the absence of information. So the implications for the candidate. Candidates choose campaign strategies in this order. They want to maximize winning. If they're positive on X, reveal X. It's the best payoff. If they're negative on X but positive on Y, reveal Y. It's the next best payoff. If the candidate's assigned to be negative on both, but the opponent's negative on Y, reveal the opponent being negative. Go negative. Likewise, if the opponent's bad on X, go negative and reveal it. Or finally, do not campaign, right? Sophisticated voters can infer this hierarchy. If the candidate chooses three, it means one and two can't be true. That candidate must be bad on both X and Y. But naive voters cannot, and we show in our data, cannot infer the hierarchy, even when incentivized to do, by payoffs that incent them to do the best possible job that they can. And these were real money payoffs. People walked away with anywhere between 20 and 30 bucks from the lab for about an hour's work doing it. What did we find? Quick summary. When the candidate is positive on X, the candidates actually do reveal X. So candidates were rational. They revealed X 92% of the time when they were positive on it. But we also see in our data more negative campaigning on the dimension voters care the most about, that is the highest payoff, when the candidates themselves actually have negative traits, so I don't have anything positive to say about me, and when the prior probability that the candidate has a positive trait is actually higher. Why? Because it's the opponent going negative in order to offset voters thinking, in the lack of information, that the candidate's likely to be positive. Completely inconsistent with sophisticated voter, better explained by naive voting. Without negativity, naive voters make mistakes and fail to understand. They have to have negativity. Negativity is required for a complete information environment. So, where are we? Voters are not as angered about candidates talking about opponents if they're not cued first to think about it as negative. If nearly all advertising is negative, it's probably worthwhile to distinguish the topics. The public may claim it wants less negativity, but the loss of information would be, in fact, counterproductive. And I didn't talk about this, but our evidence also suggests voters give more scrutiny to negative campaigns and treat them more skeptically, which they should. Okay? So here's another example of a negative ad, but another way to possibly consider going negative. Let me try to get this actually up here. Because, you know, if you're going to bother voters, you might as well bother them in a positive way with your negative ad.
Something smells in Hillsborough, and this time, it's not a farm. It's shady dealings between Hillsborough Republicans and greedy developers. Republican candidate Chickie Haynes takes thousands from developers. Then she votes to approve the Mill Lane development, bringing more overcrowding and more congestion. And now the FBI is investigating Republican officials. P.U. Let's clear the air. Let's re-elect Dave Redlawsk for honest leadership to protect open space and clean up government.
So I want to point out the green smoke, right? People usually kind of smile or laugh at that or what have you. When we ran this ad, remember I showed you the ad against me. This is the same campaign. So we gave as good as we got. But when we ran this ad, we didn't get the blowback that they did, because we had green smoke and smiling kids and, you know, holding their nose. And then we had the positive at the end, right? The good guy in green in the open space and what have you. I think that's one way you can approach it, right? If we need negativity in the environment, maybe we can approach it a little more positively. Here's another approach, and I really like this. I was on leave and worked on a campaign for a guy who was running as a challenger against an incumbent congressman, a 30-year incumbent. At the end of the campaign, there was a story in the LA Times, nice guy will finish last and first in Iowa. And essentially, the LA Times called this the nicest congressional campaign in the country. Brief real-world example highlights this. The 2006 Loebsack for Congress campaign, Iowa District 2, Democrat Dave Loebsack challenging 30-year incumbent Republican Jim Leach, ran ads that included the announcer saying Jim Leach is a good man, but then subsequently attacking him as out of touch and too connected to George Bush and Dick Cheney. These ads were clearly within the working definition of negative, employed by most research, but rather than voters and the media responding in horror, Loebsack got credit for calling Leach a good man in the LA Times story, right? So let me show you the actual ad. So I think this is really instructive.
For 30 years, Republican Jim Leach has been in Congress. He's a good man, but we cannot afford to support him anymore. Jim Leach's first vote will be for Republican Denny Hester to lead Congress. He is powerless to hold the Bush administration accountable. But Dave Loebsack will, as part of a new Congress.
I'm Dave Loebsack, and I approve this message because it's time for real change.
So I don't know. Yeah, I know it's green too. I don't know about you, and I'm really not sure what the LA Times reporter was thinking here, because if all I saw was this ad, I wouldn't say Dave Loebsack's a nice guy and he didn't go negative. There's one little tiny line in there: Jim Leach is a good man, and the rest of it is hit, 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 right? But you apparently can inoculate yourselves. So let me finish by just reading a little bit from our conclusion. Now let's imagine a world without negativity. How much more competitive would elections be? Not at all, we suspect. In fact, banning negativity could be the ultimate in incumbent protection, as challengers would find themselves fighting with one hand tied behind their backs. Incumbents usually have more money, certainly have more name recognition, and press coverage, and have the potential advantage of a record to extol, perhaps even by stretching the truth about their accomplishments, which the opponent would be unable to counter. So where is a challenger left in such a world? Our basic argument then is if we somehow get rid of negativity, if we somehow say we really shouldn't have negativity, what we will also end up with are non-competitive campaigns, campaigns in which incumbents are likely to win, they already are, but even more likely, simply because no one on the other side can challenge them. And we don't think that's a great idea. Thanks very much.
So I think we're going to do a Q&A now. Please remember that we're filming for YouTube, so wait for the microphone, and please state your name and where you're from. Professor Redlawsk, would you like to pick the first question?
Sure. Right over here.
I have a real problem. I'm Joe Melton, by the way, Kathy Kleeman's husband. I have a real problem separating the issues of truthfulness and negativity, because I think that the vast majority of negative ads are misleading at best, absolute outright lies at worst. Mm-hmm. So how do we cleave those two apart in terms of what people, how people view this, and particularly when you're talking about naive voters, you know?
Well, this is absolutely the way most of us view it, right? I mean, negativity is also untruthful, and it's likely to be untruthful, and there's lots of incentive to be untruthful, so why not be untruthful? This is a part we only address somewhat peripherally in the book, but I would direct you to the work by John Gear, his 2006 book on In Defense of Negativity. One of the really important findings he has is that negative ads are far better documented than positive ads. That is, within the ad itself, there is documentation. These ads almost always have footnotes. They, you know, whether they're on paper, whether they're on video, they have places you can go to look at them. What Gear finds is that these ads are actually more likely to be truthful than positive ads. That positive ads are generally undocumented. They're generally puffery. You know, they're a little bit like 4 out of 5 dentists say you should vote for Dave Redlawsk, right? Well, yeah. I mean, that stuff is often just not documented where the negativity is. Does that mean there is not any untruthful negativity? No, of course it doesn't, right? I showed you an example of what I will tell you was untruthful negativity. I did not take $52,000. I'll say that again. On the other hand, our negative ad was true. There was an FBI investigation going on. There were the other things we argued. They were documented, and they were there. Because negativity gets the scrutiny that it does, there's powerful incentive for a campaign to actually document it properly. Do they ever cross the line? Of course they do. Do they hope they can get away with it? Of course they do. To us, the best response to that comes from the other side. It's kind of like the Kay Hagan response to the Elizabeth Dole ad. Okay? Dole clearly stepped over a line. Hagan clearly responded.
I'm John Weingart. I have two questions or observations to sort of follow on Joe's. I kept thinking during your talk about, on the one hand, the Swift boat ads against John Kerry in 2004, and on the other, Mitt Romney saying in 2012, Obama's plans are going to cost the country jobs, my plan's going to create jobs. Both of them mention the opponent, so they're negative in that sense. So I wonder if you distinguish between them in your study. And the second question is, was there any way in your study to see the impact on undecided voters as opposed to other voters?
Right. So on the first point and the question about maybe some kind of way to distinguish between the Swift vote ads and Romney's essentially issue ads, right? What Obama's doing is going to be bad. What I'll do is going to be good on this particular topic. The Swift vote ads, as you may recall, were would probably fall within the category of character ads. The claim was that John Kerry did not have the level of character necessary to be president because of all these things that, you know, he had not told the truth about in Vietnam or in the context of the war. I would argue that both are perfectly legitimate topics. That is, that I think it's really important that we be able to assess not just issues, but the character of the people we want to elect. And that in order to do that assessment, we need information, whether it's positive or negative, we need information. I think in the case of Swift vote, the really interesting problem for Kerry was that he did not respond, right? He did not respond. He took the tack, which happens actually quite a lot, that's beneath me to respond to. If I respond to it, I'll just make it worse. I'll keep bringing it, you know, they'll keep bringing it up. I really should just let it go, which is inevitably, or virtually inevitably, a terrible strategy in a campaign. There's actually some pretty good evidence in early studies that failing to respond is a bad idea. And you know, you might think politically I might not have been particularly thrilled about those ads, but I think from the standpoint of putting things into the environment, I don't actually know how true or false they were. There were people who talked about there was evidence presented and maybe they went over some line, but Kerry should have responded to it is what it comes down to. But I think both topics are perfectly reasonable. Talk about the issues, talk about character. I think those are okay. Oh, I'm sorry, the undecided voters. We didn't address that in here at all, unfortunately. You know, there's only so much you can do in any one project, and that wasn't one of the things we did. I'm going to do a couple on this side now, Danielle, so you can stay over.
I'm Harvey Waterman. I'm at Rutgers. Dave, the idea that a person is good on an issue or bad on an issue suggests that everybody will see it that way. But in fact, one of the reasons there's so little positive campaigning, I think, is that candidates are afraid to be specific on an issue because no matter what they say, somebody who might vote for them is not going to like it, which drives one of the drivers of negative campaigning. You know, talk about how the other guy is bad, and that doesn't put you on the line for saying something that'll bother someone. So can you comment on that?
No, I mean, this is an interesting problem when you're a candidate, right? I mean, your ultimate goal, having been there, is to win 50% plus one if it's a two-candidate election so that you're the one sitting up there when it comes time to be sworn in and not the other guy. That's your goal. One of the really interesting things, though, that happens, I think, is that candidates get into this point that I need everybody to love me. And they're afraid to say anything on the fear that everybody won't love me. And I think that actually is a problem. I do think the lack of specificity about what people want to do, the positive side, is problematic. But it comes mainly because of the incentive structure for the candidate, which is, you know, I know someone's not going to like what I do or what I say, but I don't know how many someone's. I can poll it, I can try to find out, but, you know, I need 50% plus one, but it'd be a lot better if I got 75%, make it a lot easier. The fact is, though, that even when we talk about campaigns being unrelentingly negative, there's some data that suggests that in 2008, in the last month of the campaign, there was not a single positive ad from the McCain side, and virtually none from Obama, but there were a couple from Obama. But they were almost all negative. But you can't just look at it that way. You have to look at it over the long run of the entire campaign. What you'll typically find is there's a lot more positivity early on when candidates are introducing themselves, when they're defining themselves, when they're saying, here's what I'm going to do, here's who I am. But I agree, they could be more specific. It would be a lot more helpful to us if they would be. But that doesn't say they shouldn't be negative. I think being negative is part of the game. Jerry, no, I'll come here. I'm not sure I should let Jerry ask me a question. He got to do that roughly 20 years ago in my qualifying exam defense. And I did a terrible job of answering one of the questions he asked.
You see, he's just told a lie because he didn't do a bad job.
Memories fade.
What I'm concerned about is sort of impossible to reconcile. Most of the research on yours is what a candidate's trying to do, how effective is it, does it work out to a candidate's advantage, what are the strategies, and so on. But you know, elections are really not about candidates in one basic sense. Elections are about voters controlling their government. And what I worry about, and I have no solution for this, is how do you get voters to do more thinking, to make the entire discourse more elegant, more responsible? And candidates don't give a shit about that.
No, we
know about that.
Yeah. We want 50% plus, but it's YouTube, Ruth.
But how, what are the ways in which we can get the candidates in that direction? I have no solutions to this. But to discourage lying, exaggeration, undocumented facts, et cetera.
Well, I mean, I definitely subscribe to the idea that the way you address bad speech is by more speech, right? So the way you address inaccurate ads is by directly addressing those inaccurate ads. And so having an opportunity to respond, to reply, what have you. That suggests, of course, that resources are reasonably balanced so that, in fact, you can do that. And we know in most elections they are not particularly well balanced, so it makes any kind of dialogue difficult. I don't, you know, if I had an answer to your underlying question, I probably wouldn't be standing here. I'd be like, you know, on television somewhere, not just YouTube. And, you know, yeah. I mean, the fact is, I think about my own campaigns, which were at local office, admittedly. You can actually talk to voters, and you can knock on most of the doors in town if you spend enough time doing it. And I felt great incentive as a challenger, which I was in the first campaigns, to present what I was going to do, to try to create some kind of dialogue that said, here's who I am, what I am. I think you will find that's often true of challengers. We don't hear about a lot because most challengers are underfunded, have very little chance. But I think to some degree, one of the things a challenger has to actually do is say, here's an alternative and why it's a good alternative. They also have to go negative. I think they have to say why you should stop doing what you've been doing for the last 30 years in the case of the campaign I showed you, or the ad that I showed you. But I don't think that's enough when you're a challenger. But Jerry, the bigger question is really about voters. And voters are busy people. You know, most people are busy people. Most people have a lot going on in their lives besides politics. We know, both from research I've done with Rick Law and research that lots of other people have done, that, you know, for the most part, we make these decisions with relatively little information, with heuristics and cues, partisanship in a general election. I don't know that I want to be that negative about voters. I think in some sense, the political world is really complex, and we're asking a lot of voters to become really well-informed about it. I think the candidates owe voters a lot, and that's what would help them become more informed if the information was there to start with. I had Paul here was next.
I'm Paul Weiner. To me, people don't trust government anymore. It's not WikiLeaks. It's not Obama promising things that were wrong. People just don't trust, and when they, particularly myself, when I hear a debate and people are campaigning, I don't trust them. Mm-hmm. Whatever they say, I don't trust them. I don't have the time to go and do fact-checking. Right. But what do you comment about that, how it turns off American voters?
Well, I mean, it's obviously a problem. The drop in trust is very well documented, and you can take it back to a lot of different possibilities, but one certainly has to do with the post-Watergate era and the switch in the way the media saw its role. You know, prior to that, we had a media that you could argue was almost sort of complicit in making government look good. And following that, you had a media that was much more focused on where are the problems, we got to get them out there, the public has a right to know. So I have very few solutions here, folks, sorry. And trust is another one. I don't have a real solution, because we almost seem to me to have a system that virtually ensures people are going to have a hard time trusting it, because candidates tell us all kinds of things and then they never do them. I mean, you disclaimed that as a reason, but the underlying sense that government can't do anything is partly a structural problem with the way our government's designed. If we had a parliamentary system, the party that won the majority would put through its program, and voters could either agree with it or disagree with it, could keep them in office or throw them out. We don't have something so simple and clear, right? And I think it is a problem. I think part of the issue has to do with candidates, much as Jerry kind of suggested, not doing their part to kind of improve the environment. But I'm not sure that would actually solve the trust problem anymore. We may just be so far down that road. Ruth.
Sort of a half a comment, and then I have a question at the end. Because following up on what you said, all I keep thinking of is toxicity mm-hmm. in the environment, especially sitting here at an Institute of Politics and an educational institution where one of our missions is to educate students and introduce them to the reality, but also to encourage them to get involved and to think about public service in some kind of positive way, right, because we need people in public service, and we need good people, and we need people with some sense of idealism. We don't need people, only people who are cynical and say, well, you know, this is the way, this is the ugliness, and so I'll be part of it. I keep, you know, I was trying, and this is a bad analogy, but I kept thinking about, I get angry at the fruit I eat. I remember when I was a little kid, I had strawberries that tasted incredible, and I can't find any that taste like that anymore, and I could name you a list of other fruits. And, you know, we all get used to it because that's all that's available. And it seems to me that the environment is polluted, the political environment is polluted, and that this adds to it. And whether or not you can prove through research techniques that, you know, this is effective or it's not effective, there are values questions and there are underlying visions and values questions. And to what extent we have a responsibility to take that on, and then you say no answers, and I'm with you, we don't, but how do we even begin to approach that and kind of embrace it as a responsibility? That's what, you know, that's what keeps me awake at night, thinking about what our responsibility is to change it. So that's the comment. The question is, to what extent, unless I didn't hear and you might not have addressed it, are there, what are the kind of demographic difference, what are the gender differences to responses to negativity? And I'm interested also in other groups' different kinds of responses, but particularly in, because of the work I do in gender responses.
We thought about spending some significant time on trying to understand the wellsprings of support or opposition, that is, like the demographics, what have you. As it turns out, that's for another project. We've got data, right, because we've got data on who our subjects were, who the people who participated is, or were rather, and we ran some models. And the problem is I can't pull off the top of my head right now what differences we saw, but it strikes me that had we seen, for example, gender as a major factor in responses here, I'd remember that, because it would have struck me. And so we weren't really delving into that level at this stage of this work, but we are looking forward on the work, and we intend to do some more analysis of these data and collect some additional data as well. I do want to quick comment on the other part of Ruth's comment. Yeah, you know, it's really easy to get cynical about all of it, right? And I've been in this thing, I've been attacked, I've done the attacking. As I said, I'm kind of a recovering politician. I promised when I came here that I would no longer do partisan politics, and I'm glad I made that promise, and I'm glad I'm not doing it. But I also kind of miss it, in a sense, even with the bad. And I try to, that's the thing I think we want to try to get across to the students as much as we can. It is rough and tumble, as I said on one thing. It is difficult. There are challenges. You do need a thick skin if you're going to put yourself out there. But if you really believe in yourself and believe that you have something to offer, then this is an incredibly noble calling with all of the horrible things that surround it. And I, despite the book, want to try to get that point across, at least to my students.
Yeah, but yeah. There's still the challenge of whether you can be partisan and not toxic.
Yeah, no, that's right. That's right. And you can be partisan and not toxic. I pointed out the Loebsack campaign, and he did win that. He did beat Jim Leach by 1.5 points. It was a shock in 2006. I don't think it was because of that ad. There were a whole lot of other things going on. But Dave really is a nice guy. And the campaign was, for the most part, a nice campaign. The LA Times reporter wasn't completely wrong. You can do this. You can even go negative without being toxic. But it does seem to be harder and harder to find. Right. Yes, ma'am.
Looking back over the many decades I've been a junkie, that if a campaign is close, or if whoever is losing feels they have a chance to win, they will more often than not go negative, very negative. Mm-hmm. The most recent example was Benjamin Netanyahu, which it wasn't even in our country. but I mean, there are so many examples in this country. And when I saw the title of your book, I thought the contents of the book were going to be two words long, saying, because it works. Or, it works. And it has worked, in my opinion, far too often in this country, that candidates have not been held accountable when they really go, what I would consider, over the border, I mean, over the boundary of what is fair and reasonable, like Elizabeth Dole mm-hmm. did there. Sometimes they're accountable for it, and other times they're not. The one thing that the Kerry and the Swift vote and Michael Dukakis had in common was they never addressed what was being attacked. So you are 1,000% correct on that. If it's going to get thrown, you better have a research team ready the way Clinton did, 24-hour turnaround, you got an answer for it. So would you advise candidates to go negative if it's really close and they're desperate at the
end? The fact is, the more competitive the election, the more likely there's going to be negativity in the election. And it's due to a lot of things, including the very fact that the election is competitive. And so many of them are not, particularly congressional elections. I can already tell you pretty much who's going to win the New Jersey congressional seats in 2016, right? I mean, these are generally not competitive elections. But when you get into a competitive environment, you need to use every tool that's available to you. And negativity is one of those tools. Used properly, it really does add information into the environment. Used properly, you as the perpetrator can, in a sense, inoculate yourself against criticism for doing it. Because as we showed in some of these examples, you can run ads that are negative, but do it in a way that isn't necessarily toxic. It isn't necessarily just tearing everything apart, right? But I want to say one quick thing, and that is there's actually very little evidence about whether negativity works. And the reason for that is really simple. We don't know what would have happened otherwise, right? And for every negative campaign where the candidate won, I can point to something where the candidate lost. Even in my own 1998 reelection campaign, both sides went negative, one side won, one side lost. So it turns out to be really difficult from a political science standpoint to actually identify whether or not negativity works. Rick Law, who was here earlier and had to leave, has done some analyses on that and has found no evidence that it actually works in the form that it always results, or I should say always, but predominantly results in what the candidate perpetrating it wants. Back in the corner, actually, one of the students, and then I'll switch back to this side.
Hi, Liz Cantor. Okay, so you say that negative campaigning is necessary because it helps provide full information. So then where does that leave the press and other outside unaffiliated actors who have the power to provide both positive and negative information about each candidate?
We have an entire chapter on that in which we basically say the press can't do it. I didn't talk anything about that at all, and it's not an empirical chapter in the sense that we did some kind of experiments or collected data in that sense, but we spent a lot of time looking at how the press does deal with negativity, and in particular, fact checks. And what we found are a couple things. Firstly, we found the public, interestingly enough, at least the people we surveyed, trust the press even less than they trust political candidates. So if you start from there, how is the press going to hold anybody to account? And then we found that these fact checks, while they're kind of cute and interesting, there's some good evidence that they perpetuate the negativity that they talk about from two ways. One is they repeat it, right? So they're way back in the Dukakis campaign, the Willie Horton ad, which is sort of famous as a negative ad. It invoked race, it invoked a number of things. Literally ran once on television. Very few people actually saw it in its original run. But by the time it was done, because of the media reporting on it, virtually everybody saw it. And that's the problem with the media side of it. The second way that they perpetuate it is they report on it, not even talk about fact checking. The media, we've got some data that suggests that media stories, about 80% of media stories on a campaign are about negativity. It's almost as if you don't go negative, you're not going to get covered. So that's kind of our answer to the idea that the media could take care of it for us. Okay. Over on this side. Yes, sir.
Sorry, please wait for the mic.
Daniel, I'll get you the mic here.
Yeah, Thomas Simmons, Graduate School of Education. I would say that with your ad particularly, where you were really scandalized, and he came out and said what he did, until candidates are held up to a higher standard and possibly even prosecuted for offenses like this, you will never see the end of this type of situation. I mean, another instance that's come up recently is Senator Harry Reid came out against Mitt Romney saying that he never filed his taxes. until someone like Harry Reid is actually prosecuted for a blatant lie like that, and your opponent, you'll never see an end to this type of thing.
So the challenge we face is this little thing called the First Amendment. And it's an interesting challenge, right? Because on one level, we hold, and the Supreme Court has ruled, and we should under the First Amendment, we hold political speech as virtually sacrosanct. Virtually anything can be said in the context of political speech because it's meant to be open and free. And as I noted before, you know, the best way of dealing with it, with hateful speech or inaccurate speech, is more speech. That's the ethos that sits on the First Amendment. Doesn't mean it's impossible to hold people to account. Every now and then it does happen. It's just an extremely high bar. You might think, for example, that a candidate who's attacked in a clearly vicious lie would have recourse, let's say, to a slander or libel case, a private action in some form, rather than the person being prosecuted. And the answer is sort of. That is, the Supreme Court has said essentially that public figures generally cannot carry a libel or slander case successfully unless they can prove that it was done with malicious intent and the statement is knowingly false. And those turn out to be much higher bars than you think they are. So in some sense, you're right. We can't, in the legal sense, hold people to account by prosecution or even by private action very readily. My argument would be you hold them to account by responding in the campaign context. It's in the campaign context, that's where it should happen. That's how I would look at it.
Susan Gulliford, Hillsborough Township.
Yeah. But this was 20 years ago.
I was there.
Oh, you were there. Uh-oh.
I don't terrible press people in those days.
I won't ask you which way you voted.
negative ads with negative ads with documentation, you mentioned it. Okay, in this day and age, with everything being online, it's so simple for voters to pull it up and look at it and see all the cut and paste that was done to make the little comment on the mail or whatever. Is the assumption made that most people aren't going to take the time to do it?
Well, most people aren't going to take the time to do it. That's absolutely true. It goes somewhat to Jerry's point, too. I mean, voters are busy people, right? We all are busy people. And politics just, sadly, isn't central to most people's lives, even though I think it should be, right? So they're not. And so once again, somebody has to do it. And there's no reason in my mind that the other side can't do it or shouldn't do it. I think they should, right? But I also recognize, I mean, there are resource issues. Sometimes you don't have the ability to respond. It's not as nice as it is in theory and all, you know, everyone can speak and everyone can be heard. But I think at least from a theoretical standpoint, that remains the answer. Now, I think it'd be great if voters would all go look things up, right? And maybe it's not that they all have to. Maybe just some critical mass or some group has to and then respond. That's another possibility. It is easier now than it was back when I was doing this. Right. Okay. Any others? Yes, sir. Okay, so I'm told last two. I was wondering if someone was going to save me eventually. So.
Yeah, I'm afraid this question may be, you know, the next session or something like that. But anyway, I was really curious what the situation is in other advanced democracies.
Yeah, I'm an Americanist. I study America. The fact is that the United States, however, to my knowledge, is a leader in lots of things. And that includes certain kinds of campaign techniques. But they're no longer non-existent or even rare in other countries. Israel was mentioned earlier as an example. And even in Great Britain, I mean, they've moved to an environment where there's actually potential for political advertising. The stuff that goes on isn't the kind of television stuff that we're used to. But, you know, there are attack ads. There are things that are done on flyers and at people's doorsteps and what have you. I'm pretty sure, I'm only saying this off the top of my head, of course, that we remain a leader on this. But I can tell you that a number of American political consultants are making good money consulting in other democracies. So I'm sure they're not far behind. So is there a last question? There was one over here. Oh, yeah.
Hi, my name is Bonnie Kelter. I'm a graduate student in governmental accounting. It was actually a perfect lead-in to your answer to that question about the standard to determine cause for libel or slander, and that was knowingly right. To attack.
Yeah, yeah.
I was wondering if there was a difference in the ads that you noticed when the law that said a candidate has to say that I personally approve this message.
That's a good question. This was the various reformers that are out there have lots of ideas for making everything better. And one of the ways of making everything better was to say to candidates, well, you're going to have to appear in your ad and you're going to have to stand by your ad. You know that chart I showed you at the beginning, right, where it's always getting worse? It's been getting, you know, it's more since then, not less. Nothing has changed in that sense. And there's no particular reason that it should. I mean, in some sense, it's pro forma. You know, the candidate's there, okay, so. But if you notice, like Hagen's response to Dole, and even Dole's ad, you know, they actually now tend to work it into the script in a way that it's not really jumping out at you. So in some sense, it's almost not, it's not doing what I think the reformers thought it would do, which is saying, I'm taking responsibility. Right, I approve this message. I approve this message because I'm a great person and the other guy's horrible. Right? I mean, maybe had the reformers made you say, I am taking responsibility for this ad, I don't know, maybe that would have been a little bit different. Anyway, thanks very much. I appreciate your attention.